Hi, this is Gregor from BassTheWorld.com, and today I have the pleasure to show you two new basses from a brand that you've eventually never heard before. It's called Supra basses, and I have two basses, Sapphire Deluxe 4 with a Bubinga top and this beautiful Emerald 5 Fretless behind me with a Koa top. Let's check them out. Last year I attended a bass event here in Germany, and at some point a guy approached me and said, "Hey, I know you as a reviewer, and would you mind having a look at one of the basses that I've just built?" And he told me that he had just started out, and this is like the prototype for a bassist that he's planning to build in future. And so he handed me over a 5-string bass. Was ash body, olive top, very beautiful bass, and very well built. And I checked it out for half an hour maybe, and I fell in love with it right away. This bass was so good on so many levels that I couldn't believe that this was actually one of the first basses this guy has ever built. So I handed him back over and said, "There's really nothing I could tell you that could be improved here. Everything seems perfect." This bass seemed to me like a masterpiece, I would say. Something like you would expect from a luthier to build after 25 years of experience, after figuring out what kind of woods to use, also where to purchase them, because there are huge differences in wood qualities when you buy them, and also finding the right pickups, the right positions, the right preamp. Everything has to work together perfectly to build such a masterpiece. And yeah, this was a prototype and he nailed it right away. I couldn't believe it. However, long story short, I fell in love with the space, and a couple of weeks ago he contacted me again and said, "I moved to a different city here in Germany now, and I have now a workshop built up and it's running now and the first real production models are ready." And yeah, he wanted to bring me this space here to for this video review here. So yeah, he came over, and let's check it out. So let's start with the Sapphire 4 Deluxe. This is a neck through bass. As you can see here, we have a 4-piece maple neck. We have swamp ash body wings, which also means the bass is relatively lightweight, I guess slightly above 4 kilos, something like that, which is convenient for a 4-string bass. Another little cool detail on the back is the battery compartment has a cover that is held by magnets, and you can just need a little bit of fingernails and then you can pull it off very easily, and this is really cool. And what you can also see is there are two different 9-volt batteries in here. That means, yeah, it's an 18-volt EQ running here. Then we have a Bubinga top, which looks very, very beautiful. Even the pickup covers are made from Bubinga. And this reminds me a lot of the Cody Wright bass that he's playing, the Sound bass, which has a Bubinga top as well. The ebony fingerboard has 24 frets and a 20-inch radius, so it's relatively flat. And both ebony and Bubinga are relatively hardwoods. That means sound-wise this bass is a bit more on the harder, harsher side of things. You have a lot of treble, usually not so many mids, very tight or rather tight basses. And in combination with the neck through design, we have a bass that has a very fast attack, a very long sustain, and a lot of clarity. If you like basses that are the complete opposite of what you expect an old Fender P bass to be like, this is your bass. Mm. for the electronics, Tomasz, the guy who's building these Supra basses, is using two EMG single coils with this bass. These are active pickups with a relatively high output volume, and these pickups are very well known for a very clean and almost surgical tone. They give you the whole frequency range, and every little detail that happens in such a bass is transferred by these kind of pickups. And as you can see, the pickups are moved relatively close to the bridge. That means they will emphasize also this this very defined sound that this bass has. At some point, we could think that all these things together are maybe a little bit extreme, but yeah, just from playing this bass and from hearing it, I think it's just the perfect measure. It's extreme, of course, but if you like these kind of sounds, this is kind of the holy grail, I would say, this bass, because it just works together very well. For the electronics, we have a Mike Pope preamp in here, which is really cool. This preamp really has everything that you could ever need. We have the master volume underneath. We have a passive tone control, just like you know it from a passive jazz bass or P basses or whatever. We have the balance for the pickups, and then we have active basses, treble, high mids and low mids. So anything you could ever need. We also have an active passive switch, which is only for the EQ, because you can't really play this bass passive because the pickups need power all the time. Another thing that's really cool with this bass is the bridge. Because this piece here is made from wood, I guess he started with a Goto bridge and then replaced the frame here with this wooden piece, and I think it looks really cool and it feels great, but he told me that he's not sure if this will work out for a longer time, because of course these strings have a lot of tension, they are pulling at this the bridge all the time, and yeah, he will check it every now and then how the condition of the bridge still is, and then decide over time if this is something he can do with other basses, or he just leaves it here and will maybe just replace it by a different bridge one day. But I think it's a cool idea, and for a bridge is still kind of a prototype, this bass, try these kind of things out. I think it's a good idea. The tuners come from Warwick, and Tomasz replaced the tuning keys with pieces of Bubinga, which also match the top, which is really cool. Not like the average jazz bass that every player would just grab from the wall and do his thing. This is a rather special bass for special players with special types of music playing. Where I would mainly see this actually is in solo bass circumstances. I know this is not really a genre and it's a little thing, but with all the qualities that this bass has, I think these special qualities that it has, they would shine the most in these circumstances. Only one instrument where you can hear all the little details, all the amazing harmonics coming out of here, all these little bits and things that make this bass so good. I think they would, in a band scenario, there's a lot of stuff just going down the road, because you have all these instruments and all these frequencies and all these instruments fighting against each other. If you want to enjoy the full amazing quality of this bass, just hear it alone and you will cry at some point. I love this bass so much that during the time that I had it here in the studio now, we tried to use it in every other video. So there are at least three other videos where this bass will be where you can hear it. We recently recorded the Glockenklang demo for the Steamhammer amp, the intro amp, this amazing slap thing Lars is doing is played on the space, and soon there will be two more videos with a tube amp and a cool recording preamp where we use the space too, because for this kind of trebly sounds, for tapping and slapping stuff, this space is just amazing, and especially for tapping and these kind of things, I would say I've never heard a better bass, and I've never played a better bass for this kind of stuff. Really, thumbs up, Tomasz, for this bass. This is really a masterpiece. Awesome stuff. ¶¶ Tomasz brought me the four string. He told me after a couple of minutes that he has another bass in the trunk of his car, and it's a five string fretless, and maybe he knows me as a reviewer, and maybe I'd really, yeah, of course, just bring it. Just bring it here. I want to try it out. And I loved it so much that I convinced him to leave it here as well, because I think it's a completely new brand, and it's good to show you that this bass is a little bit extreme, and yeah, just to show you that this is not everything he does. He built all kind of basses, and this bass is, I would say, it's a fretless, but other than that, it's a way more normal bass than the four string. So just to give you an idea that not everything is as extreme as the four string, extreme in a good way. However, this is the Emerald five string fretless. The difference between this five string Emerald here and the four string Sapphire is not just that this is a fretless, but also this is a bolt-on construction. It means we have a swamp-ash body, it's a two-piece body. We have a three-piece maple neck in a satin finish, which feels amazing. On the front, we have, again, an ebony fingerboard, which is like the standard wood for fretless basses. And the top here is made from koa, and it's kept in a high-gloss finish, which looks very sweet, almost like candy or something like this. And koa is, I think, as for basses, very well known for being on the Victor Bailey signature basses, on the jazz bass, but also on the acoustic basses that he used when he was still alive. Electronic is also a little bit different. Here we have two Aguilar DCB pickups, which are really good sounding Supra pickups, and the EQ comes from Nordstrand, and this is a little bit special, I would say. Here in this position we have the master volume, which is also the active passive switch. Here's the balance for the pickups, and then we have passive tone control, just like with any other passive instrument, and then we have active basses and treble. This switch here, however, is a mute switch or a kill switch, and something that I would say is rarely found on electric basses, but I don't know why he's using it, but yeah, I think it certainly opens up some creative ideas. If you need some input, what you can do with it, just like check some videos of Buckethead or Tom Morello, these are guys using kill switches on their guitars and doing some really cool effects with this. The bridge on this bass comes from Schaller, and I think it's a 2000 model with these roller saddles, and this is super high quality, made in Germany. The tuners are again from Warwick, and yeah, I think that's all I can say about technical details with this bass. He's using Dunlop flat-one strings on this bass, which I like a lot, and yeah, this bass is sonically completely the opposite of the four-string. Four-string, very harsh, very bright, all these details and all these little sound bit information, and this is a bass that is very warm sounding and very organic, and so I think, yeah, these work very well together to cover both sides of the spectrum. All in all, I'm astonished and I'm a little bit afraid, because I've worked with a lot of guys coming up building basses, because I was working in retail for many years, and I'm doing this job here as a reviewer for a couple of years now, also working for a German magazine. I'm writing articles for them for almost 10 years now. And so I've worked with a lot of companies that just started out and bring me prototypes to get some ideas. And honestly, I've never had a company with first production basis in this quality level. Not that other companies don't use the high quality parts. It's not about that. It's about finding the right pieces that really work well together. And this is something that needs to be figured out over years, sometimes over decades. And some companies, to be honest, never find the good combinations. That's just like it is. So I'm very astonished that a guy who just started out has such a good sense of things going together. And as I said before, to become a master in something takes at least 25 years to figure all this stuff out. And I'm very interested to see what this guy is building in 25 years, because these basses will be out of this world. And also how these basses will sound in 25 years when they are a little bit older. When instruments get older, the woods are still drying all the time. They're still losing humidity, and they get this great resonance that we are familiar from vintage instruments. And at some point, these basses will be vintage too and will sound even better than they do today. And this is just amazing. I don't want to say any more things. I think I said more than enough positive things about these basses. This is an amazing brand, and I don't want to talk about prices with high-priced instruments here, but compared to other companies playing in this league, I would say these are even relatively affordable. This is, I think, 4,200 euros, something like that. This is slightly above 5,000 euro. I know this is a lot of money. I don't want to say this is not much. It definitely isn't a lot of money. I personally wouldn't spend so much money on a bass. But when you look at other brands like Alembic, Fodera, they have a lot of basses. Yeah, they charge sometimes 20,000 euros or dollar for basses, which I don't really understand. Quality-wise, it's hard for any company to get close to what especially this bass delivers. This is a masterpiece. This is like one out of a thousand bass. So you can't buy a 10,000 euro Fodera and expect it to be as good like this. And I don't want to bash Fodera here, but this is just as it is. These basses are exceptional, and I highly recommend, if you ever get a chance to if you see this guy at a bass event exhibiting some basses, definitely try them out. I'm sure you will be as blown away as I am right now. However, if this all sounds interesting to you, check him out. I think he has a website going live right now or this week or something. And I'm looking forward to see what else he comes up with in the next years. If you have any questions, just leave them in the comment section below. And otherwise, have a wonderful day, and see you next time. Bye.